It's just recording.
Yeah, it's recording the whole time.
Oh, got you.
Welcome. Welcome from Alpha to Omega. To Omega.
Hello, and welcome to the 24th episode of From Alpha to Omega. Today is Saturday, the 26th of January, 2013, and I'm your host, Tom O'Brien. This week's show is sponsored by the serial repeat donor, David B. I may have to rename the show from David B to Omega. If you would like to enter a futile bidding war with David B to have your name included in the podcast title, feel free to click on that there donate button. And while you're at it, why not follow the show on Twitter or Facebook? This week, we welcome back Philip Pilkington to the show to talk about his latest writings about the life and influence of Friedrich von Hayek, the ideologue behind the Neoliberal project. You can find Philip's writing on the Naked Capitalism blog, the third most popular economics blog on the web. We joined the interview as I tried to get my head around what the hell liberalism means, never mind neoliberalism.
Before we start talking about neoliberalism, I suppose we need to define what liberalism was in an economic sense.
Well, I mean, it could probably go back to John Locke and all about property rights and everything like that, but I guess in the modern context, it's usually Adam Smith, right? And liberalism was a reaction against what was generally referred to as mercantilism, how most governments ran their economies prior to that. It was a system that was designed to generate as much gold and as much treasure as possible by exporting as much as possible to other countries while protecting against imports, similar to what we see countries like Germany and all these doing today. And this was a very unworkable policy, and it also led to wars. I mean, it quite obviously led to wars. If all your treasure was being accumulated and your whole modus operandi was to accumulate treasure, then you're eventually going to get in a fight or whatever. And so Adam Smith and David Hume and all them were obviously seeing that this was a very dysfunctional system, and so they were saying that trade should be liberalised and that the domestic economy should be liberalised. I think that today we put more emphasis on, like, neoliberalism, just to, you know, step forward a bit in the conversation, is more so about the domestic economy being liberalised. And I think that the classical liberals were probably more concerned with free trade than they were about...
Between states.
Between countries, exactly. I mean, I think that they were really moving against a very unenlightened system of countries essentially fighting each other on economic policy. And the protectionist measures and stuff that were being taken in a warlike manner, which we again saw in the 1930s and... It is actually very unenlightened. I'm not exactly a huge advocate of free trade per se, but if you're going to use protectionist measures and stuff, there's more than one way to skin a cat. So deploying protectionist measures to engage in economic warfare is a little bit different from being a developing country. But the classic liberals, anyway, as far as domestic policy and stuff like that went, they were very enlightenment, and they were also very radical insofar as they were against monopolies. They weren't as against a government intervention as the Austrians and these, but they were more concerned with concentrations of power, I think.
So, who was Friedrich von Hayek then?
Friedrich von Hayek was an Austrian school economist whose main economic writings were taking place, were being published in the 1920s and 1930s. And in the 1940s and after that, he had pretty much stopped publishing a lot of economic theory, and he became much more focused on political philosophy. Now, the reason for that, I think, is because he'd been proved wrong in his economics. His economics was very simplified, it was very, I'd say, naive, it was also very utopian, and it had been proved largely wrong by the events of the Great Depression, and the less remembered but also important events that were taking place in the 1920s across Europe, which also exhibited depression-like conditions in many countries, especially the UK. He assumed that these problems would just correct themselves, and it was quite clear that they weren't correcting themselves and that they wouldn't. So on the pragmatic front, Hayek was wrong, but also a lot of criticisms were being published in the economic journals at the time, most notably by John Maynard Keynes and Piero Serafa. And these had showed serious logical inconsistencies in von Hayek's arguments, mainly related to the theory of interest as a self-regulating mechanism of the capitalist economy. And so he found that he couldn't really hide from the real world in his logical constructions, as it were. So he instead began to publish what I consider political propaganda. I mean, today it's referred to as political philosophy, and some people might see it as political philosophy, but I see this as an entirely different turn. I think that he realized that he could no longer coherently and cogently argue economics anymore, so he started taking a different line and trying to convince people through rhetoric that focused on issues, very contentious issues like freedom. You know, I mean, at least in economics, we can have a debate because we both understand the meaning of a certain term, but freedom is obviously different things to different people. So he started getting more interested in the philosophical side, which is far more contentious, but it's also far easier to get converts with.
So in what sense were his liberal economic thoughts also ideological? Like, Marx was highly critical of classical liberal economists for ignoring the role of social relation in capitalist economics. In what level was he always ideological?
Yeah, I mean, I tend to agree. A lot of the Austrian school guys became very, very hostile to Marxism because Marxism was gaining serious traction at the turn of the 19th century, moving into the 20th century. Marxism was gaining a lot of traction. A lot of Marx's criticisms of classical economics were certainly correct on their own terms. So the Austrian school had moved in the direction it was moving, partially as a response to the failures of classical economics that Marxism has exposed. Or not so much failures as, if you interpret it in a slightly different way, you come to a very different conclusion. And it was also a reaction against the political situation at the time. I mean, in Austria, there was a Marxist school called the Austro-Marxism, I think it was called. And they were seen to be having quite significant influence in Germany as well. There was quite a strong Marxist influence culminating in a revolution after the First World War. And even if there wasn't what was at the time called a Bolshevik influence, which was a radical communist influence, there were labour union movements that were spearheaded by social democratic politicians like Karl Kautsky, who was a Marxist and who understood the world in terms of class conflicts and everything like that. While they weren't radical communists, they were seen to be moving the economy in a different direction. So certainly the theories that were constructed by the Austrian school were a reaction against Marxism. I think it would be a misreading of history to not think so. But they also saw themselves as value-free. And they saw themselves as putting criticisms to Marxism based on pure logic, if you will, and then constructing an argument based on pure logic, much as Marx saw his criticisms of classical political economy. So I think it is worth emphasizing that Hayek moved away from this, because I think it's a lot more difficult to find contentions with a purely logical doctrine for its ideological implications than it is to just point out a sort of a crude political ideology.
So Road to Serfdom was his most famous work. What was this all about?
Well, I mean, this was what I'd call the founding myth of neoliberalism. I think that the importance of this work has been hugely underestimated in the history of ideas. By me, up until I started reading this, I really thought that this was sort of a fringe doctrine that a few people sort of picked up on, and Margaret Thatcher liked and all this. But I think there was an undercurrent that this was sort of a mythological foundation for the neoliberalism that followed. The work itself was written in Britain while Hayek was teaching at the London School of Economics. He'd fled Austria prior to Hitler annexing it. And he didn't want to go back, obviously, because he didn't like Hitler very much, and he probably wouldn't have been very popular back in Austria. He was writing this in Britain, and he had seen the warfare welfare state grow up in Britain during the war. And in Britain during the war, the economy was basically planned. I mean, it was a capitalist economy, there's no doubt about that, but it was a strongly planned capitalist economy.
In what sense?
Well, one example would be that wages and prices were controlled. If you're running a war economy and you don't have these controls in place, you'll get significant inflation because everything, all the goods and services are being sent over to the front and essentially being destroyed. So there's shortages at home, and if you leave it up to the market to decide, people will go out and they'll bid up prices on everything, on petrol, on toilet rolls, on everything. So in a wartime environment, you have the choice between letting the economy sort it out, and that would mean inflation, and it leads to huge economic difficulties, or you can put wage pricing controls in place, and you can operate on a shortage basis, on a ration system where they'll hand around tickets and stuff. This is obviously a far more effective way of running a war economy. It's controlled. Yes, people are deprived of things, but they'd be deprived anyway of them in the inflation. They just wouldn't have enough money to purchase them. So it's a far more effective way of running a wartime economy. That was the main way in which it was controlled. Also, the government were directing investment. If they needed what would have been a car manufacturer prior to the war to produce more tanks, they wouldn't obviously leave it up to market incentives, because that wouldn't make any sense, because there are no market incentives to produce a load of tanks or Thompson machine guns or something like that. So they had to just say, hey, factory owner, produce the goddamn tanks and Thompson machine guns. We need X amount to send them off to the front. But the industries were never truly nationalised or anything. I mean, they were still run on a quasi-capitalist basis. Well, so Hayek saw this all taking place, and he knew that this would fundamentally change the nature of the British economy after the war. Because once you put this planning in place, especially once you've assured full employment, which was the case during the war, people are going to expect some of this stability to remain after the war, especially considering that they just come out of, in Britain, a period of 20 years of economic chaos prior to this, and the war proved a very stabilising function. I mean, obviously there were shortages and everything, but people appreciated the fact that life was well managed as opposed to the chaos that had come before. So Hayek could see that this was going to have lasting implications on the structure of the British economy after the war. And so he started making comparisons with Nazi Germany and with the Soviet planned economy. More so with Nazi Germany, I think, because he'd actually experienced some of that directly. And what he started arguing was that this would lead to totalitarianism. This was a complete misinterpretation of history, and it was just fabricated, it was made up. Now, this is the part that I call Hayek's delusion. So the reason I call it Hayek's delusion is because I have a choice of either saying that Hayek was making this up because he was a liar, or because he had made himself believe it. And I think if you read his writings, it's quite obvious that he made himself believe this. So I think it's more fair to call it a delusion. Not in the psychotic sense or the medical sense, but more so a delusion like you might refer to a person in a cult as being deluded. He was saying in The Road to Serfdom that this planning of the economy was going to lead... Essentially, he was hinting that it was going to lead to Hitler, or at least a totalitarian system.
And was there any systemic, logical steps, he said, that would cause it, or was it more just a leap of his imagination?
He just seemed to think that the centralisation of power would automatically lead to totalitarianism. I mean, it's not difficult to see how you could make that leap in your imagination, obviously. Orwell was saying something quite similar in 1984, or at least he was hinting at it. But I don't think Hayek appreciated the fact that in Germany and in Russia, the totalitarianism came first and the planning came afterwards. Planning is a feature of all economies. The economies we live in today are planned to a huge extent, but we don't live in totalitarian societies. And okay, there may be some similarities, and we can all say that 1984 has partially come true, and there's certainly a surveillance state more so than there was 40 years ago, and so on. But I mean, the proof that we don't live in a totalitarian society is that I'm allowed to do this interview right now, right? And there isn't a man in a black uniform standing outside. So it's not a necessary connection, but Hayek seemed to insinuate that it was. And I think that this is one of the most important myths propagated in the 20th century. Because even today, if you make any overtures towards government engaging in some sort of intervention in the economy and some sort of planning, even though government massively intervenes in the economy and does a huge amount of planning, already. If you say, let's extend this a little bit further, once you break down a person's logical argument to that, which isn't actually very difficult, they will start saying, you're totalitarian, you know what this will end in, it'll be Stalin, it'll be Hitler. And this all goes back to Hayek, and this performs such an important ideological role in establishing what can and what can't be said on both the left and the right.
You know, Niels Bohr, quantum physics, once was visited in his country house by a friend. There he had above the entrance door a horseshoe. In Central Europe, the superstitious item signaling destined, that's the idea, to prevent evil spirits to enter the house. And the friend asks him, why do you have this here? Are you stupid? Are you superstitious? And Niels Bohr gave him a perfect answer. No, I'm not stupid. I'm a scientist. Of course, I don't believe in it. But I have it there because I was told that it works even if you don't believe in it. That's ideology today. We don't believe in it. We are all cynics. But actually, we believe in it much more.
In Europe, we had nearly two separate types of totalitarianism. We had like the Marxist, socialist, Leninist type, where the revolution was undertaken to seize control of the state and try and make society more equitable. And then we had the fascist version of totalitarianism, where state and corporate powers were merged to defend and enrich the already powerful and rich. Did he even distinguish between these two totalitarianisms in his critique?
If he did, I don't think he made it very obvious. I might say, no, he didn't, and an Austrian is going to show me an obscure passage on page 204. But no, I mean, the overarching message after World War II on both the right and the left were that totalitarianism were all the same thing. Whether it be Hannah Arendt saying the origins of totalitarianism, whatever that means, or it be von Hayek saying that all totalitarianism came out of central planning of the state, they were just mixing up two completely different systems. I mean, that the two systems had abolished democracy, had stymied private freedom. I mean, these are all similarities, but they were completely different systems in just about every way imaginable. I mean, to compare them and to pick out similarities and then to put them under one name is completely arbitrary. I could compare Nazi Germany, and this is what Hayek did, this is the rhetorical trick, I could compare it to today's economies and pick out similarities, and then rhetorically I could equate them under some new name. We can do this, but it's not valid, and it's a rhetorical tactic.
So how was the road to serfdom then received?
Well, at first, people were quite, I wouldn't say hostile, it certainly wasn't mainstream. I'd say that the road to serfdom today is a mainstream political idea. I don't know how many people have read it, but it's a very mainstream idea. If you gave the road to serfdom to most people who read non-fiction books, they will identify with what's in it in some shape or form. Again, on the right or the left, they'll throw up concerns about totalitarianism and so on and so on. But it wasn't received, it wasn't in keeping with the popular mindset after the war. After the war, people appreciated the degree of planning which had been built into the economy. Certainly there was a move away from planning, wage and price controls were lifted, the government no longer directly channeled investment, although they did occasionally look into tax incentives and subsidies and all this, which I will say they still do today, so it hasn't actually, most of the planning that was kept in place after the war still exists today. It really hasn't been rolled back. But it's now shown to be a negative and something we should be rolling back, even though we never do. And the whole idea seems to be to keep it from being any more planning, as it were. So it's all still there. But the difference, I guess, today, between today and after the war, was that after the war, people quite appreciated this. They saw it as a very structured society. Many people remember it today as the Golden Age, the 1950s and 1960s. It was a very structured society. Things worked. Your governments were highly accountable insofar as if things weren't working economically, if unemployment raised above a certain percentage number, the government would be thrown out. And the next government would come in and it would fix the problem, which obviously we don't have today. This is the complete opposite of today. So people really appreciated this move toward a more organized society. Whereas today, any further move toward organizing our society and any move toward responding to problems that disorganization have caused in our society are subject to Hayek's delusion. You are engaged in totalitarian planning and so on.
Was there a difference between how it was received, say, in Europe and the US?
Yes. The nature of the planning systems in Europe and the US was fundamentally the same, but they were advertised in different ways. The US, even though there was planning in the economy and people accepted that, they hated the word socialism. It was despised. Socialism was seen as an evil in the US, even after the war. People did not like the word socialism. They didn't like using it. Whereas in Europe, people were more sympathetic to socialism. I mean, a lot of people in the post-war era would have considered themselves socialists. Now, as I said, the economic planning that was going on was largely the same on both continents, with differences. I mean, obviously, in the UK, we have a national health service, and in the US, we don't. But the nature of the planning apparatus was very different. And a lot of it was done more so for the public purpose in Europe. So we'd get institutions that would protect people and stuff like that. And that's how the economic planning took place. While in the US, that would have been undertaken as a sort of a socialist policy. Even if it was undertaken by conservative governments, which it often was, governments like the British Conservatives and General de Gaulle in France undertook these policies, even then it was still seen as a sort of a socialist remedy. And then the conservative mindset would have been, we have to limit this so it doesn't impinge on private property rights. But they saw that some sort of socialistic institutions had to be put in place. Whereas in America, a lot of the planning took place through the military-industrial complex. And that's largely how it was sold to people. It was sold as part of the Cold War. So rather ironically, the same processes of planning were sold as when it was directly tied to the military-industrial complex as part of fighting the Soviets, while when it was a policy measure or an institution geared towards helping people live day-to-day, it would have been, well, we need a stable capitalism because otherwise people might turn to socialism and so on.
A big role in the economy for the state was popular with the corporations and in the boardrooms across America at the time.
Yeah, it became normalised in the war. I mean, the corporations were always quite hostile towards too much government intervention because it impinged on their power, certainly. But I think there was some enlightened self-interest. It was generally recognised that in the 50s and 60s, things were better than they were in the 20s and 30s. And although not many economists seem to realise today, beyond Keynesians, that if a government spends, most of that spending will directly go to corporate profits. So they could see that this was a more profitable system, it was a more equitable system, the system ticked over. But I think there was always kind of discontent. There was always kind of these other government institutions now had power that prior to that only the corporations had possessed. Probably for every enlightened CEO, there was an unenlightened CEO.
And what role did the Mont Perelin Society play in this right-wing resurgence?
This was kind of central. The Mont Perelin Society, if we were to put it one way, was almost the clutch, transmitting the libertarian, radical, right-wing message into mainstream discourse. Because Austrians like von Hayek were extremists, and they remain extremists today, and their direct followers today, who you'll see on the internet and so forth, are extremists. There's no doubt about that. They have a very extreme agenda. They would not function well in democratically elected politics. Despite the fact Ron Paul got a few votes, I don't think Ron Paul would have functioned very well if he ever got into power. Theirs is an extremist ideology. The Mont Pelerin Society was able to transform that ideology, that broad ideology, into a more applicable political model. And that political model is what we call neoliberalism today. It was basically a debating society where von Hayek ruled the roost, essentially. But it was fairly open. and people who had like-minded ideals of society. So people who would appreciate Hayek's overarching message, but think that he went a bit too far, would come along and they'd all trash out ideas that were right-wing without being fringe right-wing. But in doing so, they spread Hayek's basic political message, and this is again what I call Hayek's delusion. It's that any sort of economic planning will lead to totalitarian eventually. I think that would have been a consensus attitude of the Mont Perelin society, pretty much.
And what were the main differences then between the neoliberalism that emerged from this society and classic liberalism?
Well, there were huge differences. Neoliberalism as a doctrine is basically the idea that not that we should get rid of the state from interfering with the economy, but more so that the state should be made to pursue certain goals, and these are the goals of the market. As Hayek's borderline anarchism was translated into real politics, it became something that Hayek probably wouldn't have quite recognized, but which he sort of sanctioned anyway, because it was really the only way to practically go about this. So this was to change government institutions into institutions that weren't engaged in autonomous planning, but were subject themselves to market forces. And this is what we have today. This is why I say we didn't actually get rid of the planning after the war, because that would have been a huge rewind back to the 19th century. But instead, we rejigged the political institutions to plan in a way that ideologically was consistent with the idea of so-called free market.
Look at this lead pencil. There's not a single person in the world who could make this pencil. Remarkable statement? Not at all. The wood from which it's made, for all I know, comes from a tree that was cut down in the state of Washington. To cut down that tree, it took a saw. To make the saw, it took steel. To make the steel, it took iron ore. This black center, we call it lead, but it's really graphite. I'm not sure where it comes from, but I think it comes from some mines in South America. This red top up here, the eraser, bit of rubber, probably comes from Malaya, where the rubber tree isn't even native. It was imported from South America by some businessmen with the help of the British government. This brass ferrule, I haven't the slightest idea where it came from, or the paint that made the black lines, or the glue that holds it together. Literally thousands of people cooperated to make this pencil. People who don't speak the same language, who practice different religions, who might hate one another if they ever met. When you go down to the store and buy this pencil, you are in effect trading a few minutes of your time for a few seconds of the time of all those thousands of people. What brought them together and induced them to cooperate to make this pencil? There was no commissar sending out orders from some central office. It was the magic of the price system, the impersonal operation of prices, that brought them together and got them to cooperate to make this pencil so that you could have it for a trifling sum. That is why the operation of the free market is so essential, not only to promote productive efficiency, but even more, to foster harmony and peace among the peoples of the world.
Well, everything now is it's implicitly thought that they should be subject to market forces. In the UK at the moment, they've been doing this with the NHS, with Blair. They've been saying, you know, the NHS doesn't work, and rather than actually looking into the reasons that they're having problems with the NHS, as a rational planner would, because this is a planned healthcare system, and a rational planner would go, well, let's look at what's wrong with this and see what we need to do to fix it. Instead, there's sort of a catch-all solution. Well, it just needs to be subject to market forces. So they put in quota systems, and these are completely dysfunctional, but they completely ignore that it's dysfunctional. It's craziness. But and what the end result of imposing these rigid doctrines that are purely utopian and metaphysical constructs on the reality of planning is that the planning system itself begins to degrade, decay, and break down. And we see this almost everywhere now. I mean, you could make a case that the big banks are big planned corporations. I think this is what they are. They're not little
mom-and-pop stores.
No, they're not little mom-and-pop stores or banks or whatever that are subject to market forces. We all know that. They're big corporate planned entities. And it was assumed during the era of neoliberalism that if these are left to quasi-market forces and we can ensure that within these structures something resembling market forces is operating, that they'll achieve an efficient result. But of course they don't achieve an efficient result. But again, this is contrary if we want to compare that, for example, to how we treated the banking system after World War II. That was a completely different approach. That was, it's recognised that banks can be a problem, it's recognised that they're huge planned corporate structures, and what we need to do as a government is have an independent entity that puts in place a planning system that prevents these banks from getting out of hand. Comparing those two things, you can see the gulf of difference. While the mechanisms are essentially the same, the government's still there, the government's still involved in the financial sector, it's involved in a completely different way. I'd say that the authority is on the side of the banks rather than on the side of the government. Perhaps that's a good way to describe neoliberalism, that it's not so much that the government gets out of these things as it is that the government, it subordinates itself to corporate power, I mean, if you want to put it that way. Yeah.
In another sense, if we look at, to say, what you mentioned about how Tony Blair brought privatisation into the NHS, some of that you could see as a way of basically siphoning off profits or increasing profits of the private sector as opposed to maybe more efficient public services. It was also successful because it opened up a certain amount of the state budget to be able to siphon off to, say, private owners of capital.
Yeah, I mean, well, this is definitely, as I said, when you try and plan in this way and you use so-called market forces to plan your economy, what you'll very rapidly see is that your economy will start to not grow as fast. It'll start to become extremely inefficient. It'll start being subject to financial crises. In most of these countries, you see, with the exception of Germany, which is a completely different thing, but that's a separate issue altogether. But in Britain and the US, we see trade deficits open up. These become interminable. Domestically, the economy, I would argue, largely rots from the inside out. You see huge problems with demand because wages don't go up. So it becomes more and more difficult for a capitalist to turn a profit in these circumstances. I mean, in a well-planned economy, it's not very difficult to set up a successful business because there's full employment. But if unemployment is going up every few years and there's recessions and there's financial crises and all this, it becomes more difficult to turn a profit within that economy. So what I think happens is they just start picking the bones of the state, basically. You just get systems that are still semi-functional, like the healthcare system, and you buy it up, and people need to use it, and people expect a certain standard of living, and then you just pick the bones. But it doesn't seem to me to be a sustainable way of doing business.
So you mentioned also in one of the articles the Leninist attitude of neoliberal thinking. Well, what do you mean by that, then?
This is the idea that it's not really a hands-off approach at all. It's a very strongly interventionist approach.
Is it a kind of a corporate seizure of the state power? Is that what you mean by it?
I don't think it's even... I really don't see this in terms of one sector has taken over the other. I mean, there's an element to this. I think this is really just a series of ideas and taboos that prevent people from doing certain things and a prevailing attitude towards how government should be structured. And certainly this results in good returns for certain people. Politicians can be fairly lazy. They don't really have to give the public anything, to be honest. And corporations at the same time gain a huge amount of autonomy. But again, the Leninist comment, it's a bit of a throwaway comment, but it is the idea that not only that do we have to intervene in order to restructure these institutions, but in the Mont Perelin society, and especially Hayek's close circle, you see an idea that since the masses aren't willing to listen because they're content with the state planning system that they believe is eventually going to turn totalitarian and chew them up, because of this, an enlightened circle have to spread these ideas and possibly take over political parties, take over government. That is a very Leninist idea insofar as it's strongly elitist and assumes that a small group of people knows better than the rest of society.
Like a vanguard of intellectuals.
An intellectual vanguard, exactly. So what the opposite of Leninism in my mind would be democracy. What I mean is this is an anti-democratic idea.
How strong was the influence of Hayek on Milton Friedman and his monetarist policies?
Well, Milton Friedman was a member of the Mont Perelin Society. He was very sympathetic towards what I call Hayek's delusion, Hayek's ideology, whatever you want to call it. He seemed to strongly believe in this idea that planning was a bad idea and that it might lead to totalitarianism. And he published a book in the 60s, I think, which was called Capitalism and Freedom, which was sort of a watered-down version of The Road to Serfdom, to serve an American audience, because The Road to Serfdom was very lofty and philosophical, and it was very European, whereas they needed something kind of crass, a bit crude for the American readers.
Apologies now to all Americans.
No offense to Americans at all. It's easier to... Americans have a different style of discourse. They prefer engineering-like terms and very scientific-sounding terminology rather than the European sort of philosophical approach.
Continental philosophy.
Yeah, I don't even say this to denigrate it. Both contain the same nonsense. It's just one's written in a more philosophical style and one's written more like an engineering textbook. But they say the same thing. So Milton Friedman published Capitalism and Freedom as basically the American equivalent to The Road to Serfdom. But his approach was more pragmatic and more neoliberal than Hayek's. Because, as I've already said, Hayek was a bit of a fringe character and a bit of an extremist, and Milton Friedman understood quite well that he had to construct a macroeconomic policy that he could give to governments that they could use pragmatically, which Hayek never succeeded in doing, because it seemed he was perhaps unable to do it and perhaps unwilling, I'm not really sure. But Friedman came up with a sort of nice technocratic answer how to manage the economy, but it relied, obviously, only using the banking system to manage the economy. So in that sense, it was a very nice fit with neoliberalism, because everything else was left to market forces or institutions controlled by government that promoted market forces.
Can we say a little bit more about what exactly Friedman's solution was as opposed to Hayek's?
Well, Hayek didn't really have a solution. Hayek was a very sort of philosophical character. He was almost like a preacher or something. He was telling people what freedom meant and what freedom didn't mean and what tyranny was. And these are very abstract terms that good politician or technocrat might use as rhetoric, but they don't really have much functional value, really, when you're trying to run things. And Friedman was more of a sort of a policy wonk, I guess they call them nowadays. And he understood that, you know, governments had to do something to manage the economy. And his approach was to have the central bank control the money supply, the government to promote neoliberal policies apart from that, privatizations, all the things that we've been talking about. So Hayek, it just wasn't really his field. Hayek was more comfortable talking about grand truths with a capital G and a capital T.
Was Friedman in favour of Keynesian policies in times of crisis?
No, he thought that everything could be controlled through the money supply. This is very vague.
So was he against all statist interventions, even things like the military-industrial complex in America?
Honestly, I don't know what Friedman's stance on the military-industrial complex was. I'd imagine that he didn't make very many public pronouncements about it. I'd say think of Friedman like you'd think of the modern Republican Party. They ignore things when it's inconvenient to them. But positively speaking, Friedman certainly didn't seem to believe that the government was a very effective way of managing resources. At the back of his mind was probably that it would lead to totalitarianism in some shape or form. And so he generally promoted these neoliberal solutions to things. As far as the military-industrial complex, I think that's a bit of a taboo issue even today for conservatives. Because on the one hand, a lot of conservatives are actually quite libertarian in their views about the military-industrial complex. But on the other hand, they know that most of their policies are sold based on using propaganda tied to the military-industrial complex. So we all know what the modern conservative movement is like and how they deal or don't deal with these issues.
Ladies and gentlemen, the President of the United States.
Good evening, my fellow Americans. We now stand 10 years past the midpoint of a century that has witnessed 4 major wars among great nations. Until the latest of our world conflicts, the United States had no armaments industry. American makers of plowshares could, with time and as required, make swords as well. But we can no longer risk emergency improvisation of national defense. We have been compelled to create a permanent armaments industry of vast proportions. Added to this, 3.5 million men and women are directly engaged in the defense establishment. Now, this conjunction of an immense military establishment and a large arms industry is new in the American experience. The total influence, economic, political, even spiritual, is felt in every city, every state house, every office of the federal government. We recognize the imperative need for this development. Yet we must not fail to comprehend its grave implications. Our toil, resources, and livelihood are all involved. So is the very structure of our society.
So who were the Ordoliberals then? And what were their differences with the Neoliberals?
The Ordoliberals grew up in Germany. They were mainly, again, centred around the Mont Perelin Society, or at least had connections to it. I'm sure they had their own organisations in Germany. They had to deal with a different political situation to the American neoliberals like Friedman. In Europe, we had really, really strong trade unions. I mean, we still do today. They may have essentially adopted the neoliberal mantra, but trade unions today are much stronger than they are in the US, and they're much more institutionally integrated in most continental European countries, and in Ireland, not so much in Britain. But they knew that they had to accommodate the trade unions. And whereas people like Hayek and his close circle were fairly willing to accommodate corporations, they really didn't like trade unions. And this, I think, was pure politics. It was double standards on their part, but they just hated workers' organisations. They saw this as the seeds of socialism. So the Ordoliberals were sort of a response to Hayek, that they fundamentally agreed with what he was trying to do, but they recognised that they had to accommodate the trade unions in Europe. So they came up with an ideology called Ordoliberalism, which is similar in many ways to neoliberalism, with privatisation and planning based on so-called market forces, as we've talked about. But they also thought that the trade unions could provide a really good role in essentially controlling wages and keeping them down. This was the idea. The idea of social partnership was formed that is in place in much of Europe today, Ireland and Germany included. And the idea is to have trade unions that are essentially inculcated into the neoliberal doctrine. And the way you sell it to trade unions is you say, if you go over this level of wages, and if you aren't good about your negotiating tactics, this will result in unemployment, which will not only be bad for your workers, but it will destroy you as a union, because you know that if unemployment goes up, you'll have less members and so on and so on. So, ordoliberalism was really clever in a lot of ways, and I think most of the political situation in Europe can't be understood without understanding the ordoliberal model. We still have such strong trade unions in Europe, and yet the political forces to fix the current system are so weak. And the reason is because you can be left-wing or you can be right-wing, but you're not going to have any power unless you adhere to neoliberal ideas. So the trade unions are just as, they're left-wing, they like having a welfare state. Some of them might even call themselves socialist. But they believe in these basic principles that if you have too much planning, it will result in totalitarianism. If you push wages up too much, it'll result in unemployment. that was essentially what the ordoliberalism dogma seems to me to have been about.
These ordoliberal policies seem to have had an actual effect on our current euro currency crisis.
Well, their main base was in Germany. I think they're pretty much everywhere across Europe. But ordoliberalism grew up in Germany and is a German construct fundamentally. And Germany's been the most successful in essentially constructing an ordoliberal state insofar as their unions are completely under the heel of this ideology. And they are fully willing to drive wages down to levels that in other countries would be deemed unacceptable. And in Germany, in order to maintain employment and incomes and everything like that, since there isn't sufficient domestic demand from wages, the model has been export-orientated. And they've maintained this by putting in place the single currency, which means that other countries can't devalue against them and are essentially forced into accepting their imports, building up enormous debt, and then when this whole thing falls apart, the countries themselves are to blame, Germany isn't to blame, and Germany demands that they start undertaking self-destructive policies. But the problem with this is that when it stops working, it stops working. And at the moment, we're seeing fear in Germany that unemployment's going to start to go up. And if that starts happening, even the unions, who my impression of the German unions is that they're almost entirely under the sway of ordo-liberal or neoliberal ideas, if unemployment starts going up and they haven't risen wages, they're going to start asking why is this happening. So in a sort of a sense, the crisis, although I'm pretty pessimistic about what's happening in Europe and what will happen in the next 10 years, it has shattered that doctrine to a large extent, or at least that doctrine's in the process of being shattered in Germany.
Would it be apt then to describe neoliberalism as a way to try and maintain the social and economic relations within a society in a way that was hoped to be more stable than the old liberal ideal?
Than the old classical liberal ideal?
So it would get rid of the bad depressions, keep some of the strength of the state, but make it somewhat more amenable to market forces.
In neoliberal discourse, there is no stabilising features. This is the huge problem with it.
But the state is stronger than, say, it would have been in the 20s or the 1910s or the 30s.
Yeah, I mean, the state's stronger, but...
So in that sense, a large proportion of the economy is going to be, the GDP would be a state part. But what they want to do is to increase, essentially, the non-state element in that economy, which would be more stable than maybe 100 years ago, but not so planned as it was in, say, the 50s.
No, I think this is just a transplanting of some aspects of the liberal doctrine into a theory of governance, essentially, of how the state should go about its business. I don't want to say plan, because they don't plan. They encourage what they call market units or something like that, institutions to reform in a way that they think will promote what they consider to be market forces. But there is no stabilisation here. There's absolutely none. I mean, any stabilisation that takes place in neoliberal regimes is a hangover of post-World War II institutions like social welfare or something like that. And if the neoliberals had their way and they pushed these things to be more subject to market forces, or what they call market forces, you'd see that things would destabilize more and more and more and more. And we're seeing this. I mean, look at the American debate at the moment over Social Security, which is essentially a debate to privatize Social Security. They're going to get concessions, it looks like, and eventually Social Security will be in some way eroded. It probably won't move toward total privatization, but this is going to destabilize the economy more.
So I'd like to say something about Hayek's thoughts on dictatorship.
Hayek's thoughts on dictatorship developed in the 70s, it would seem, because some of his old colleagues from the Mont Perelin Society had engaged Pinochet in Chile. And Margaret Thatcher, who was a big supporter of Hayek, had also engaged General Pinochet in Chile. And Hayek rationalised this by saying that, essentially, to boil the argument down, authoritarianism is better than totalitarianism. Which actually might be a valid argument. I think it would probably be nicer to live under General Pinochet than it would be to live under Hitler.
What's the difference?
there aren't any death camps. I mean, they General Pinochet didn't actually try and wipe out. He didn't engage in genocide.
Well, he killed, what, 20, 30,000 people?
Yes, but he didn't try and wipe out race.
No, but say, what's the difference between him and, say, Mussolini or Franco?
Now, I don't know. Somebody might dig up a quote and prove me wrong. I'm not sure that Hayek would call Mussolini or Franco totalitarians. I think he reserved that word for Hitler and Stalin. And I think there is a bit of a difference between Mussolini and Hitler. Mussolini didn't have death camps. And they do, yeah. So it's a tough question. I agree. I mean, look.
Yeah, it's one of scale.
It's one of a scale, of course. And when you get trapped into this terminology, you're almost fighting with shadows eventually. Let's just say that Hitler's not very nice and Pinochet's not very nice. I think that that's probably the best way to put it. But von Hayek saw Pinochet as far preferable to Hitler. And if we understand that he thought that, for example, Allende, who had been ousted by Pinochet, would have turned into a Hitler or a Stalin figure, then it was fairly rational for him to say, well, Pinochet's a bit crap, but if he puts these reforms in place, at least we won't have the Stalin or Hitler figure. Mm. Now, again, this is, I consider, based on a delusion, because
Allende wasn't Stalin.
Well, he wasn't, and would he have become us? I'd say it was fairly unlikely. And beyond that, we just don't know. But this is the problem with Hayek's argument, isn't it? I mean, again, it comes back to what I was saying, that when he was engaged in economics, he was engaged in something that was at least partially scientific, and it was open to be proved or disproved, and it could be attacked or maintained on logical grounds. When you start talking about these sort of airy philosophical subjects, theories about what type of regime is going to become what, it becomes very fuzzy, and you're able to pretty much make, I think, any argument based on this.
If he couldn't get a liberal economy, he'd take a dictatorship. I don't know if I ever heard him talk about, say, more social libertarian forms of organisation, like, say, the Spanish Revolution. That doesn't seem to feature in the work of his that I've read.
No, Hayek's simple dichotomy was planning versus market. And then he'd throw around terms like freedom and tyranny and all this, but his basic dichotomy was market, which was freedom, and planning, which was totalitarianism. And if you boil all of Hayek's propaganda down, that's what it is. And it's also what's remained today. This is absolutely widespread, this idea. It's a completely absurd idea. It has no basis in history. But this is fundamentally what he thinks. I mean, if you understand the world in those terms, a lot of what Hayek said makes sense on its own terms. But, you know, I don't call it Hayek's delusion without reason. This is an absurd idea, if you will. A very childlike way of viewing the real world.
On this episode, you heard the theme tune, The Order of the Pharaonic Gestures, by Sun Ra and his orchestra, and Slavoj Žižek rapping about ideology to a sample of Bellbury Polly's Summer Round. You also heard Milton Friedman talking about his pencil and strangely evoking Marx's labour theory of value to the tune of Matthew Shipp's Equilibrium, Ike's farewell address warning of the rising power of the military-industrial complex, and you are now listening to the Flying Burrito Brothers singing The Dark Side of the Street. I'd like to thank Philip for another fascinating interview. You can check out his articles that the show is based upon and his other writings over at the Naked Capitalism blog. Thanks for listening, and I hope you join me for the next episode of From Alpha to Omega.